thank you very much indeed for coming in such huge numbers. Apologies to those of you who haven't got seats at all, or indeed comfortable seats. There's another meeting going on in the school, and that has absorbed all the seats for the other hall. So this is the best we can do. And we will try and ensure that it doesn't drag on, so that those of you who are standing don't get too exhausted. I've been asked to read out this. I don't understand it, but I'm reading it. Hashtag for this evening. Hashtag Cam City Deal for social users, social media users. Make sense?
Yes.
Fine. Okay. We are expecting Councillor Lewis Herbert, the leader of the City Council, who also chairs Greater City Deal, but he's in another meeting, unfortunately, and he's on his way here, and when he gets here, we will slot him into the programme. I was going to start with him, but we'll slot him into the programme at an appropriate place. So the programme is, I will do a very brief introduction, in the absence of Councillor Herbert. Then Claire Ruskin from Cambridge Network will talk on what the business community needs out of Milton Road. I will talk on my understanding of what we, the residents, want from Milton Road. Martin Lucas Smith will speak on behalf of the Cambridge Cycling Campaign. Edward Lee will then talk on behalf of Smarter Cambridge Transport with some alternative ideas. And Councillor Ian Manning will talk on how you can trial ideas without being too committed to them, which is a useful thing to know. I just thought to check, can you hear me at the back?
Not very well.
It's quite rare that I'm not heard well. Is that any better? Good. That'll do fine then. Okay. Each speaker will have a brief question session afterwards, and when we've done all of them, we'll have a panel session here which you can ask any questions of anyone you want. At that point, Bob Menzies, who has come here, he's the Service Director for Strategy and Development from the County Council, he will join the panel so you can ask questions if you want of him. But he's not here as a speaker this evening. When we get to the questions, it would be nice if we can keep it good-natured. The idea is to listen and to learn about things that we don't understand. In my case, there's an awful lot of that. So let's see what we can gain out of this evening. Greater Cambridge City Deal is, as we see it, inevitably feels like the cause of the problem. They're trying to sort out the congestion of the traffic on Milton Road and Histon Road. Now, they're doing lots and lots more than that, but that's the bit that affects us directly. They've got a large amount of government money, which has got to be spent quite soon, and I think that doesn't help either. And I wanted Councillor Herbert to explain that bit of it, because he understands that, and he lives with that all the time, and that would set the scene. But we'll have to accept he can't speak until he gets there. So I'm going to ask Claire Ruskin to talk to us about the needs of the business community. Happy, Claire? Thank you.
So long as you are all gentlemen, because this is actually a very difficult topic with many, many aspects to it that you will appreciate. You should be able to see that. That's good. So I'm Claire Ruskin, I run Cambridge Network, which is just my evening job because I have a day job as well. I'm born and bred in Cambridge, I've been working here or from here all of my life, and lived here through all that time, bringing up family, etc. as well. So I know the region extremely well, and I know some of the issues that we've got with it. Now Cambridge is busy, and we're actually very proud of that because we work very hard to keep it competitive for employment. It's one of the lowest unemployment areas in the country. I think we should all remember that. We do actually need to keep it moving. But our roads are getting more and more congested, and they are starting to feel like places down the road like the A1M and Stevenage.
You can't see it at the back.
We're
doing this with a microphone.
you hear if that is a little bit closer like that? If you can hear this, that will be useful. Can you just wave to me if you start not being able to hear? Yep. Oh dear, already. So you can't hear now. I'm not convinced about this one, but is that better? I have to confess I'm an engineer but not a sound engineer. Edward speaks at so many of these events that he's obviously good with the microphone technique. Can you hear now? Can you hear now? Nobody's nodding at the back there. You can't. I will try to project extremely loudly. Can you hear now?
Yes.
Okay, I'll try shouting. It might be a better technique. Cambridge is very busy, and we are trying to keep competitive employment here. We are one of the very lowest unemployment areas in the country, and in my view, we need to stay that way because my children need jobs, and their children will need jobs, and all of our young people need jobs coming along in the future. But our roads are getting very, very congested, and we can all see that. So we are starting to feel like some of the places that I travel to on business, nothing like as bad as many of those places yet. So at the moment, we have a 10 or 15 minute wait in a traffic jam, and we think that's pretty bad. It's when we get to an hour or more when the A14 or the A11 is closed that we really find it is quite disruptive to our day. But the roads are starting to feel like London, nothing like as bad as Paris or New York. And we don't want the urban sprawl of Los Angeles, which locks up as well. So trying to move towards envisaging how we can have our future generations enjoying jobs and quality of life together. Cambridge has very high employment, partly because of the quality of life, and we need to keep that as well. People come here to be creative and productive, partly because of the enjoyment of working and living here, bringing their families and doing other things. Now, Cambridge Network, which I'm CEO of in the evenings, probably represents roughly a quarter of the working population in the region. Most emphasis on the high-tech region, which I have been lucky enough to have a curiosity to grow into. So having been born in Cambridge down the Marshall's end of Newmarket Road, I've become an engineer and spent my working life engineering around the world. But I was asked to serve on the CityDeal Assembly, and it has given me a taste of public sector life, which I must admit is much harder than private sector life. So I do not envy people who spend their lives doing what I'm doing now, which is talking to you about some of the infrastructure issues. Coming to be on the CityDeal Assembly, as I realised in that very faint writing that you might be able to see up there, it was in order to help make some difficult choices and difficult decisions. People are waving so they can't hear me.
Because you're talking too fast and too quietly.
I will try to address that. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Good. So maybe, can people read the words on the slides?
Yes.
So I don't need to go through all of those. Why are people actually travelling on Milton and Euston Roads at peak times? That's the only time when we have congestion. Sometimes of the day it's absolutely free-flowing, not a problem. Mostly there are workers going from the northern part of the region, from the A14 direction, down into the town centre in the morning and coming back in the afternoon. Slightly less traffic is coming from the town, the centre of town or across town, up to the A14 area, including the science park, the business parks, and the other areas up there, including Milton, Tesco's, Water Beach, everything else to the north. Deliveries are coming across town, particularly the more we order on the internet, the more deliveries are coming around, white vans, and repair vehicles, all the rest of it, are coming across this region, particularly when the A14 is congested or broken. And I think we all recognise that when people start pouring into town down the Milton and Histon roads, there's often something going wrong on the A14. But there's also a lot of traffic that's going to education, various sorts, university and schools, and going into the hospitals and healthcare services. So I think the analysis has been done, which I'm not planning to cover here. But traffic occurs for a number of reasons, a number of different types of traffic coming in there. The things that we'll look at are the lovely cobbled streets and the regions that we would like to have our roads as places, where people are just crossing the road with their prams and their pushchairs to get to their neighbours and to go to the local shops and the local zones in there. But that is not the majority of the traffic that we're talking about here. I think it's fair to say that businesses want the clean and nice and beautiful environment as much as residents do. Businesses are not big business things. They are actually a group of people who are residents somewhere, if not in the immediate region because they can't afford it, then in a further away region. So businesses are made up of people who are residents somewhere. How can things be helped along these roads? Changing behaviours is an obvious thing to do. If we take a time difference in the travel that we're making. So if we start schools at 10 o'clock and businesses at 9 o'clock, if we start hospital appointments at 11 o'clock and just stagger the times that we're doing things, we can make a difference. If we get other people to go on the bus instead of us, then obviously that's brilliant. We can stay in our cars. If we can have people cycling or walking and going on buses, it obviously is a much better density of movement of people to both jobs and town and jobs and schools. All things. If we can find an alternative route, I think we'd be very lucky in Cambridge because there simply aren't the alternative routes at the moment. We can't envisage that. Or we can decide to work from home or use telehealth systems or any other thing that prevents us or enables us to do things without actually having to travel. All those are good things. We can put homes next to jobs, next to the hospital, but as we all appreciate, any family will be going in different directions in the morning and in the evening. So it's really hard to plan for that sort of thing. The North train station will help, provided we can get traffic in and out of it. So we've got to have it accessible. And if we take the centre out of Cambridge, I think we will agree that we don't want retail centres springing up in the far distant corners of the county. We actually do like going shopping in the centre of town, because that's what we're all enjoying at the moment. The option, obviously, then, is to make the best use of the space we have got available. And these are where the hard choices come in, which I don't think anybody likes to make anything worse than it is now. But we do have to address some of the issues that we've got. Businesses do play their part, and actually, the city deal, there's quite a lot of business input to this. So we are trying, as businesses, to encourage changes of behaviour. Companies like Cambridge Consultants on the Science Park are being very active in encouraging their staff to travel by bike or walk or coming by bus. They're giving them breakfast and showers and other things that you need when you've travelled in a different way to your car, apparently. Businesses are paying for buses to come out from the station out to the various business parks, and those are not causing congestion. They seem to be freeing up all the people from using their cars. We can help support the local skill development, and we're doing quite a lot on that, putting through programs that will bring people from the local region to be able to work in the local jobs. And obviously that helps because it reduces the traffic that you need to get between job and home. We are obviously paying business taxes and individuals pay their taxes, which all go into the infrastructure locally as well as nationally. So there's quite a lot of money coming into the system because of the high employment that we've got here. And we are one of the only regions that actually makes a net positive contribution to Treasury, which is interesting. The whole of the country, there are very few of those. If we move the businesses away, which many of them are threatening to do now, then obviously people can live closer to their workplace. Camborne is an obvious example where the lot of houses have been built with the aim of people working and living in the same zone, but unfortunately the businesses largely don't like to work out that far away. It seems a very small distance to us, but actually people want to be within distance of university departments and other businesses in the Cambridge region, so it's quite hard to encourage businesses to do that. they could also, of course, buy houses in the local region, so buying all the houses around close to the science park would have quite a different impact, which I think we would all be up in arms about even more than trying to change the road use. So lots of things that businesses can and do to help, including moving further out, so along the A10, up towards the Water Beach, Research Park, and other places will be developed. There will be more jobs and houses outside the centre. But we have to recognise that the quality of life is a total mix of people who want to work and live in a closer region. Really just bringing to your notice that the businesses are residents as well. We do want to keep competitive employment here. Otherwise, the quality of life in Cambridge and the Cambridge region will decline. If we don't have the wealth that the businesses can generate through employment, then we will be in a worse position. We know industries at the moment that are having a really tough time. We in Cambridge are extremely lucky, and I hope that we stay that way. But we do need to work together, and I would ask you not to treat businesses as different to residents. We need to work together to progress and make some room for the activities that do compete for the roads and places. There are many suggestions coming into the City Deal. I sit on the City Deal Assembly, as I mentioned. It's quite a hard place to be because there are no really good suggestions. If there was one really good suggestion, we would be taking it up straight away and delivering on it, if it was affordable. These things are all constrained by the money that is there. Whilst it sounds like a lot of money, it actually isn't that much money in the context of trying to build a new road, let alone a tunnel or a parking space or anything else. So let's try and work together. There are some good ideas that will be coming up this evening, and I hope that we can all use the consultation as a time where we put ideas in rather than just decrying that any change is a bad thing. We do need to move forward. I've been here for 55 years. Things have changed hugely, and they will change yet further in the next 20 years. Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions for Claire specifically? The lady there, there's a mic, roving mic on the left, and there's a roving mic on the right.
Hello, yes, next was a very interesting analysis. You said that there are no really good ideas, but actually, as I understand it, the Assembly has recently been looking at a really important field of ideas, range of ideas, in relation to reducing congestion, and that the Assembly actually has played a very important part in pushing the board towards making, to getting to grips with this subject, because this community is about to be sacrificed in terms of its streetscape and its public realm, without the board having tackled the question of how to reduce congestion, which might possibly reduce the need for these extremely intensive, intrusive physical measures. So, I mean, I would just ask you, perhaps if you could comment whether there's anything else that you feel that the Assembly can do or that the business sector can do, actually to advance analysis or evaluation of this range of ideas. There are various, they range from ideas that we're going to hear from Edward Lee about to workplace charging levy and closing roads and congestion charging and so on. All of them have their pros and cons, but I would ask you whether you in fact feel that those are really good ideas and that they are essential in order to protect communities like this one from brutalising their roads.
There are some good ideas. Can you hear that? I can't hear you any more than you can hear me. There are some good ideas. It's switched on now. There are some good ideas, but I said there are no very good ideas because the ideas are complex. There is no simple idea that just solves the issue. If you make 5-lane roads in and out of Cambridge, you will fill them up like the M25 is filled up. And where are the cars all going? One of the issues is that we don't have an infinite sink of places to put cars when they get into the centre. So cars are all not wanting to travel along Hills Road or Maddingley Road or Histon Road. They want to get to the place at the other end. So any of the ideas about traffic management,
the sort of ideas that everyone can bring forward all have strengths to them and can all be used in part. There is nothing that solves the issue of more people wanting to live and work in Cambridge.
Thank you.
Why has the council engaged two lots of consultants to deal with the Milton Road?
Use the microphone.
Milton Road issue and Mitchum's Court. We were shown at a meeting of local council not long ago. A proposal for so-called roundings at Mitchum's Corner.
So I think I can probably not answer that question very clearly.
Yes.
Apologies for cutting in. But I think there are...
They should have been treated as a single thing.
I'm sorry, can I interrupt you? Because the only question we can probably put there are those about the interests of the business community, not the process. There will be an opportunity, I hope, for that question to come later.
Can I just say I welcome professional input from people outside the political arena, because the people in the political arena have a very hard job choosing between the difficult decisions that are to be made, whereas the professional consultants can be completely objective on these things.
And I've heard a senior ex-Cambridge economist, who's now in America, so he's doing very well, say that there is an alternative. You build another city, possibly to the south of Cambridge, possibly it's North Stowe, into a proper city, not a tiny little town of 10,000 houses, but a proper city. You actually endow it with the best modern architecture you can imagine, and you make it attractive in its own right. And he says that maybe many people do not come to Cambridge because of its beauties, but actually for other reasons, for its schools, for example.
Yes.
Well, in the new city, you put schools that are better than the schools that we have here. How's that for solution?
So one of the issues we have is that businesses come to collaborate with the university as much as anything. So given the university is still central in Cambridge, they are moving out quite a bit as well, so the West Cambridge site, the North West site. But the essence of the Cambridge University is what draws many of the businesses here. It's not just what they could otherwise work in Milton Keynes just as well. No supplementaries allowed, I don't think.
A little bit, but one corollary, which obviously this town would only be at about 10 miles. How far away is North Stoke from Cambridge?
10 miles? 9 miles.
Okay. That's no distance in modern terms.
Yeah.
What's the size of London from one end to the other? There you are. All you're doing is you've got another city which has superb links, preferably railway links, possibly virtual working, and so forth. And you've solved the problem. It's Cambridge too.
I think you solved some of the problem. I think as before, you would still get people filling the roads here. So we're not going to reduce, you don't typically reduce congestion, even if you build something in addition. You will then get more people potentially locating from other areas to that new zone. But I'm not a professional in planning, I am an engineer. I'm sitting trying to be objective about some of the schemes that are coming forward.
Thank you very much. I'm going to draw questions on the business side to a halt now, otherwise you won't get on.
Yeah.
While the microphones are being tweaked, I'm very pleased there are two engineers in that corner. Can you hear me if I speak without?
Yes.
Good. Thank you. I'm going to talk now on what I think the residents want. Now, with what authority do I speak? None, because we've all got our own ideas, those of us who are residents. But I've thought about it, and this is what I think we want. Not how it should be achieved, but what we want to have at the end. You have never worked.
Does it work?
Yes!
Thank you. Great. No, I'll speak about them. the next speaker may well want it. It's just that I have a background that says All right. Oh yes, there's the video thing. All right, I'll speak on the microphone. Right. I'm going to talk about the outcomes, the end product we want, not how we get there. Because we've come here this evening to listen to people who know what they're talking about, who have good ideas, and they will say how we might get there. But I think these are what we want. First thing is recognition that neither Histon Road nor Milton Road are corridors. They're places where we live. And that bedevils the whole... Thank you, I'm flattered. Above all, I think we want to preserve the green, the trees, the verges, and indeed the Elizabeth Way roundabout, which is green in its own right, as well as green. We want to be able to walk safely on either side of the road, to cycle safely, not necessarily fast, but fluidly. So you don't stop, keep stopping. And we'll hear more about cycling, and it may not come out with the same idea. We want safe access to and from all our houses.
Yes. That's right.
We want safe passage to all our schools by foot and bike. We want the drains on the road to work. We want local buses that serve the residents. We want no desirable rat runs for commuters. We want to see fewer cars carrying commuters or children to school. We don't, in the process of getting here, we don't want any counterproductive measures. For instance, if you take away the roundabout and you prevent people turning sideways, how on earth are they ever going to get back to it? That sort of thing has got to be properly thought through. And we don't want any unnecessary restrictions. So, for instance, if it's deemed that there's no way of avoiding saying you can't turn right into a particular road in rush hour, that doesn't mean that you can't turn right into the particular road for the rest of the day and night.
Yeah.
This is a very high-tech town with a very high-tech arrangement round it. The university is part of the city deal. We ought to be able to find technical solutions to relatively simple things like that. We do accept that although in an ideal world we wouldn't see a green bus coming down the road at all, we've actually got to have park and ride buses and guided busway buses going from out of town to the middle of town. Now, what they're going to do when they get there is another matter, but as far as we're concerned, I think we've got to accept that we must make provision for them. But it mustn't be done to the total detriment of the residents, and we mustn't, whatever is done mustn't encourage the use of more cars. Above all, then, we want to keep the trees, we want to keep the verges, and we want to keep the roundabout. Spring is coming, and the trees are just coming into flower, if you look carefully. We don't want to lose that. What have I missed? Questions? What have I forgotten to put in there as an outcome? Oh, nothing?
Ah. Local shops and businesses which people access on foot, cycle, in the dungeon.
Did I hear you to say we want shops and businesses that people can reach without driving?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Add that to the list. Thank you.
To keep at least some option of residents parking on Histon Road so that all the side roads aren't going to be blocked off and cause accidents, which they do now even with the option of residents parking.
I'm afraid I'm struggling to hear. Richard,
excuse me. Residents parking.
To maintain some provision of residents parking on certain areas of Histon Road so that its side roads don't get blocked up completely and cause accidents.
Thank you very much. Residents parking was the plea there. For residents parking, I presume residents, not commuters parking.
Yes.
Okay.
A right-hand signal light onto Green End Road.
That's a very specific, and I don't want to go down that, but I heard it. Thank you. Now, Councillor Herbert has arrived, and when he's had a chance to draw breath, I will ask him to come and tell you a little bit about the Greater City Deal. Are you all right to go now, or do you want to wait?
Yeah.
Okay.
Apologies, I didn't want to miss a minute, but it didn't work out that way. So I'm Lewis Herbert, I'm leader of the City Council, and I'm also the City Council's representative on the City Deal Board. So I just really want to sort of say a few points which I think should help. It is an open consultation. Clearly we recognise the impact of such a set of proposals and such a discussion and the strong feelings held about the principle along a road like Milton Road, but also, as you'll see from the form of consultation, it invites people's opinions not just on the principles, but also on the detail. So within the detail, clearly, the form of the consultation, whether it's commendable or not, I think it's a reasonable consultation, makes statements about particular junctions. But as far as I'm concerned, every one of those junctions is up for discussion, and every one of those intersections is a matter that we need to look at thoroughly, because obviously, and having walked the road, each of those junctions is access for residents, it's access for school children, it's potentially a small rat run at the moment, but unless it's actually addressed, it could be a much bigger rat run. So I think there's an issue of principles, and there's obviously that, but I just wanted to underline the open thinking in terms of the junctions. Obviously there are reasons behind the proposals, and there's a detailed document underlying some of those junctions. In terms of the overall, yes, it is a road with only a finite capacity. And therefore, when we do look at what are the options, we will have to balance the environment, and we're committed to publishing a set of environmental principles in terms of the design, and it's right that the City Council put some resource into that design, like we've already started to do on areas like Mitcham's Corner, because clearly we are keen to ensure that there is a thread of good environment, and again, it is where people live. It's a place where people live. So that is the basis of it. It's an open consultation where we've prompted the meeting at North Area Committee. We don't have a sort of open forum type meeting like you might have in a parish, but that's the best thing in terms of a meeting. We appreciate that there will be strong views about Histon Road as well as Milton Road, so I think it's important that we have a discussion about both. And whilst clearly we're listening to what's being said about Milton Road, we do welcome and wait and obviously are happy to contribute to discussions about Histon Road as well. It does have to be seen as a partnership with the citywide interventions that are made. And whilst those have to take account of people outside the city as well as inside the city, and one of those aspirations is to have fast buses, not because they'll travel particularly fast on urban roads, but simply because the whole local plan is based on the addition of housing, that we need badly need affordable housing, at some distance from the city rather than encroaching further on the greenbelt. It's a balance there with the other measures. So clearly we want to encourage more reliable and better range of buses, and not just from park and rides. We've got the Cambridge North Station, although Network Rail don't seem to know when they're going to do it. We've got issues about the future of the north of the city, and also about Water Beach, which is still subject to local plan. But it will be a partnership. I mean, not everybody in this room will be convinced. There are those that think it's either bus lanes or it's another option. I don't think that's the way that I understand the challenge. It isn't the way I understand the two phases of life, or there's lots of phases of life on Milton Road, but there's a congested period and then there's other periods. And it's not in our, whilst we will aim to restrict the number of cars coming into the city as part of the broader measures, it's not in our business to say on a Sunday morning or on a weekday evening to start intervening with people's lives. We have to focus some of the measures that we do citywide on the congestion period. And some of those will include measures that dissuade people from, for instance, going right round the ring road in the centre at peak times. We'll dissuade cars coming in. So that's one thread. We will look at options, including the congestion charge, and we'll also look at flow, the issue of flow, to restrict the number of cars coming in. So, number one, the city centre, limiting it. Issues then of how many cars come in. We will need to look at issues of parking restrictions, where the community needs it and it doesn't overspill onto adjacent areas. We want to look at park and rides. We have the conundrum of stagecoach, where we think if we free up more of the city centre, then they'll have more ambition to be more flexible about buses. But we're not ready quite yet to set up our own bus service, but we certainly want to challenge the quality of there. And there will be other measures as well. But I think it's basically, in our view, it's a combination of doing that. But going back to the consultation that's in front of you, we will look at all of those opinions. There will be a good discussion with councillors, and expecting all of the North Area councillors to be there on the 4th of February. And we will stand up for the city in seeking the right balance. We have challenges. We've got to address transport in the city. I've got a grandchild, I've got children in the city. The city does have too much air pollution, and so we have to find ways of reducing that on Milton Road and in the city centre. I'm here to listen, and I will be on the 4th of February. You will judge us at the end by what we do after the consultation, and that's your right.
Thank you very much. That was very helpful. I said to Councillor Herbert when I asked him to come and speak that we wouldn't have questions now because there's a specially convened meeting of the North Area Committee on the 4th of February. Yeah, at 6 o'clock in the evening. I'm not sure. It won't be at all, they don't yet know which. But that's specifically done so that we can ask questions of Councillor Herbert and of the team. So let him off the hook now. A moment or two while the next speaker, Martin Luther Smith, sets up and tells us about cycling. Could I ask if there are any noble, young, strong people sitting down they might like to consider changing with someone who's standing? You'd rather stand up. That would be very fine.
Yes. Please do.
Martin, carry on.
So I'm Martin Lucas Smith. I'm a liaison officer for the Cambridge Cycling Campaign. And thank you very much for inviting us to this meeting. I was at my previous meeting, some of you might remember, and I think it's fantastic to see so many people here concerned about making sure that the city feels like a really fantastic place to live. We don't want the sort of six-lane superhighway going through Milton Road, I think this was before. Just very briefly, Cambridge Cycling Campaign is a local charity. We have almost 1,200 members, and I very much hope some of you might be motivated to join afterwards. And we work for better, safer and more cycling in and around Cambridge. So we often look at scrutinised traffic consultations, things like the local plan. We work basically as a sort of critical friend, if you like, to some of the councils. You know, we're not prepared to criticise, but we also want to work constructively. We've worked over, we were founded in 1995, so we've been around for 21 years now. Milton Road, we think it could be a really fantastic, lovely place. At the moment it is quite a sort of, it's rather dominated, shall we say, by the traffic. And really, what is the problem? Obviously, peak time congestion. Buses delayed at the junctions mainly, not really in the sort of bits between the junctions. And really very, very poor quality cycle infrastructure. What we are pushing for all around the city is proper, separate cycle facilities, separate from pedestrians, separate from traffic, so that anyone from 8 to 80 could use them confidently, without fear of traffic, and often, you know, a young child or on their own even. And what we see on Milton Road at the moment is basically pavements that cyclists are permitted to use, and cyclists don't like that. We don't want to be going on the pavements, nor do pedestrians. So here's the solution that has been proposed by obviously lack of trees, and very, very dominated by two bus lanes, cycle lane squeezed in. I mean, it says 2 metres there, but you know, if you're right next to a bus, you would want to be quite away from that. And I mean, what the Dutch would do, they would aim for 3 or 2.5 metre cycle provision on each side. So we think what's proposed is not the solution. It's very, very bus and car dominated. So the first thing is really about putting in place measures across the city-wide to manage congestion. Edward's obviously going to speak about some of these things, demand management. Things like smart traffic lights, about how we can control the flow of traffic between junctions and bus lanes and so on. But I think there's sort of 2 points I just want to make on demand management. First of all, we think there's a lot that Stagecoach could do to improve the way that buses actually sort of, you know, for example, come to bus stops and so on. We've been pressing for over 12 years now for Stagecoach to implement some kind of on-street ticketing, so that rather than the situation where a bus comes up and then everyone's sitting in the bus while everyone is having to pay, you can actually pay before you get on the bus. And obviously there are cars and so on. It is ridiculous in this day and age that we still have a situation, you know, where people have to wait sort of 5 minutes. And of course, what it means is the buses are very slow, because if you're trying to do an overall journey, you're having to stop each time. If anyone's who've been in London, you know the massive difference it is where you can get on a bus and it goes off straight away. And in fact, last time I was there, I was at a bus stop, and 20 people got in the space of 17 seconds. Can you imagine that in Cambridge? I think what we're saying is that there is a quid pro quo here. You know, if Stagecoach and other companies want things like bus lanes, they have to do their part as well. And the other big benefit of on-street ticketing and paying before you get in is that it massively increases the capacity for buses in the city centre. Because if a bus is waiting in the middle, and it's, you know, if they're taking fares for 5 minutes, that's 5 minutes of where that bus is taking up that space in the city centre. If the bus can basically go on, go into the centre, get people and drive out, there's a lot more capacity for buses, so there's like a quick point. The other thing briefly is on parking. I mean, parking is one of these, is very much a demand management measure. It's something that people think, you know, we need these very expensive congestion charging, all this kind of stuff, which, you know, we would have some favour with. But one way to control it is parking. If people know that there is no parking space in a lot of areas of the city, they will gradually, pretty quickly, learn not to drive there. I live in York Street, so I'm afraid I'm a southerner, shall we say, of the city. But there, the councillors have refused a residence parking scheme. And to me, it seems ridiculous that we have the county proposing £30 million plus of bus lane schemes, when people just drive into somewhere like York Street or those sorts of areas, and basically get freebie parking 5 minutes from the centre. I mean, it completely undermines all these initiatives. So that there needs to be a sense of a proper city-wide approach to parking. Maybe that means that all residents should have parking in, and it's not paper or whatever, but there needs to be that strategic element to it. Anyway, I should get on to my main part of the talk. So I think there's some sort of contextual point there. But the main thing we want to see on Milton Road, of course, is proper bicycle infrastructure. At the moment, Cambridge has, I think, about 29% of journeys by bike, which is the highest in the UK. But it's way short of places like many parts of the Netherlands, where 40 or 50% are achievable. And of course, we recognise that there are significant numbers of people who can't cycle, obviously, if you have mobility difficulties and so on. So we're not saying cycling is the only solution. But what we are saying is there are a lot of journeys that could be made by bike. And if we can make, and if we encourage those people, well, if we can provide a facility that people want to use to cycle, that effectively frees up space for people who have much less choice. And that includes, of course, people who are coming in from outside the city who may not want to cycle much longer distances. So we want to get really high-quality facilities along Milton Road and other places like Newmarket Road and so on that would enable people to cycle. And who are able to, and there's a lot of people, I think, who would if the conditions were much safer and nicer. Here's a picture from the Netherlands. It's a lovely avenue of trees, and it's a lovely place, isn't it? It's a housing, but it shows that you can sort of design streets nicely. This is a little bit more similar. This is actually to Milton Road. This is a street that's about the same width as Milton Road. But as you can see, it's a much less sort of dominant, traffic-dominated kind of feel to it. Here's another. You can see on the left-hand side there, there's a separate cycle track and there's a separate pavement, so there's no mixing of pedestrians and cycles. And again, that's a very similar width to Milton Road. And I don't know about you, but I think that sort of thing is the kind of thing that would motivate people to cycle much more than the kind of pavement, bits of grotty pavement, badly maintained pavement that we currently have. And of course, it would massively improve things for pedestrians as well. So this is a kind of example of something that could be achieved. This, in fact, is this street from Assen in Netherlands is it's actually exactly the same width as Gilbert Road, would you believe? So in fact, there's an even bit more space in Milton Road. So what you have on the right-hand side is you've got a pavement, nice and wide, you've got a cycle track, about 2.5 metres, you've got trees interspersed with parking. If you needed parking, you could just have the trees. You've got a 6 metre wide road, and you've got the same thing on the other side, although the sort of tree section is more like a set of bushes, but Milton Road, of course, is a bit wider. And you can see there I don't know what you think, but I mean, that's, again, I think the kind of thing where people who perhaps wouldn't be very confident on the bike at the moment would think, yes, I could do that, and you can see it's very direct. So whether you're someone who wants to sort of poodle along, I've got a Dutch bike, I'm definitely a poodler, or you sort of want to go much faster, you've got infrastructure that meets your needs, that doesn't sort of interfere with traffic or pedestrians, and that's a very efficient form of transport that can get a lot of people through that corridor. So, I mean, let's look at this. I mean, this isn't particularly nice. This is kind of what Milton Road sort of could become, a rather sort of expanse of concrete. Here's an existing expanse of concrete that you're going to get. It's called Newmarket Road, unless you stop it. And again, this is an area that could be easily improved towards this kind of approach. So my colleague Robin, who actually created this presentation, I sort of come in at the last minute. He's created some cross sections of how we think Milton Road could be. And so what we've got there, again, we've got a footway, we've got a cycle track, we've got trees on either side, and we've got 3 metre traffic lanes. That's without a bus lane. We show you a bus version equivalent. But this we think would be a much better way of getting a lot of people down through Milton Road. We can make planting on one side larger if you wanted to, but it's just a... Just, and if you needed car parking or car storage, as we called it, we would like to see cars... if they're going to be on the public highway, they probably shouldn't be sort of stored there for hours and hours, days and days at a time. You can intersperse the one side of the trees with the parking effect. So you need to have the tree and then parking space and so on. In fact, that picture's a similar kind of thing. So you wouldn't need to lose the parking, and yet you can have trees as well. So moving on. So no shared use. 2.5 metre cycleways each side. Priority at side roads, so you continue over the side road. You don't have to give way all the time and stop, which makes it very slow. And protected junctions, which is what I'll talk about now. And also the removal of ratlands. Obviously, ratlands are a big problem, but they also mean that people are encouraged to drive when, in fact, you could be cycling along. So what's a protected junction? Well, I'm going to just give you a little video, actually. So a protected junction is an idea from North Europe. It's the idea that bicycle traffic is completely separated from motorised traffic in both time and space at a major junction. And the pedestrian traffic, and again, pedestrians are not mixing with bikes. And so you have a separate bicycle and pedestrian phase, and all the bikes go at the same time, and at the same time as the pedestrians. And this is the kind of intersection you have to have, really, when you get up to the sort of 40, 50% level of cycling that we think is entirely achievable in this city. So I'll quickly show you a video of this. So I don't know how Robin made this. We keep getting requests from all over social media about how did you make this. So this is the junction. What we've got here along here is Milton Road. And we've actually got an example here with a bus lane, but we'll talk about that in a minute. And down to the bottom there, we've got the Newmarket Road junction. And what we've got is there are the yellow bits. They are where pedestrians are. Down on here. I'm seeing there. There's a pedestrian waiting, and the green, the darker yellow, with these little people there, the bikes. So you can see if you're sort of travelling along, you can keep going. The bike doesn't even. There's no traffic light that affects the bike. Likewise, if you're coming along Milton Road from out of town and it's only left into Newmarket Road, again, you don't need to. You just carry on going round.
You mean Elizabeth Way, actually?
Sorry, yes, of course. Sorry, yeah. Okay. Thank you. And if you need to cross over, you can see that the bike has come to this point here, just before the junction. So, effectively, the only bit that you actually cross is there. It's a very short crossing subsection. And what this means is that you can actually increase, this design would increase the number of cars that can go through this junction. Because instead of having to have a long time when you're waiting for a pedestrian to cross and a cycle to cross, it's a much shorter period because the space that you're crossing over that road is very small. And so for a lot of journeys, you never have to stop at a light. Drivers can go through more efficiently. There's no interaction between bikes and cars. And of course, it's good for pedestrians as well, who again have their own space. And we've shown here an example including a tidal bus lane. So this is the idea that we said before midday, there'd be a bus lane going into town, and after about 1 o'clock, so there'd be a dead period of an hour, after 1 o'clock until the end of the day, the bus lane would go in the opposite direction. And surely it's technologically possible to make sure that buses at other ends don't sort of both start in the bus lane these days. Maybe stagecoach can fix that one as well. But the key point about tidal bus lane is that actually, again, if you remember what I said at the beginning, it's often not really the sort of bits between the junctions the problem, it's actually at the junctions. And with modern light technology, what you can do is you can hold back, you can effectively synchronise the lights so that when a car comes in, if they know that there's a bus sort of needing to approach from behind, they can hold the cars and allow the buses through. So that then the bus has a sort of a free run of the traffic. In other words, you wouldn't actually need a bus lane all the way along the road, just as you approach the junctions. Okay, I'm going to do that. So that's the idea of a protected junction, and I'll skip through the slides, which has details of it. So just to finish off, so the bus, you could achieve a bus lane. Again, you have got the space on Milton Road. but it would only need to be used by express buses. So the problem of actually bus when you get to a bus stop, it would only be the local buses that actually need to use that. We've got some process for closing rat runs. If you're going, for example, between Castlestrawn and Haymakers, currently you've got three options. As you've got Ashen Road, which is a rat run at the moment. You've got Gilbert Road.
Is this specifically cycling?
No.
You can retain yourself from cycling because it looks like.
So I'll skip over that. But basically, there are definitely opportunities to avoid rat runs. And we showed here, for example, that that route would only have an extra 100 metres in terms of driving if you went via Chesterton Road. So I'll skip over that. Any questions?
Richard, can you bring your working bike? Hi, can I just say, I'm 99% of the traffic that is on Milton Road doesn't want to be there. The cycles, the roads, everything. They're all going somewhere else. Obviously, the people here are worried about the 1% we live here. Milton Road is an obstruction to people who are trying to get into the city. If you're cycling, you've got to cross Milton Road. Improving the routes along Milton Road, Elizabeth Way, is the wrong approach for cyclists, because what you really got to have is joined up series of networked roads off away from the main road so that people don't have to cycle down Milton Road. For example, I'd like to see Stratton Avenue, for example, being used. It's a much more direct route into the city. Comes out at the top of Castle Hill or along Chesterton Road, you go over Jesus Green. Cycling, other than for the people who live on Milton Road, don't want to use Milton Road. We don't need to do these sort of things. This is you're playing the same game as the council here, the same game as City Deal. They've divided the whole thing up into little pieces. They're not looking as an overall, joined up, integrated transport system for the whole city, which would actually mean that the 99% that don't want to be on Milton Road wouldn't come anywhere near. There'd be better ring roads around the outside, so the traffic could go around Cambridge rather than through it. There'd be better signage on the M11 and the A14 so that people didn't have to come through here. They're lost when they're on Milton Road.
Yep.
Most of them want to get to the centre. And it's the same with cycling. You need to have high quality, linked up, joined up routes going where people want to go, radial routes or whatever, around the city, which don't go anywhere near Milton Road. And then I'd support your plans.
I would certainly agree with you on the point that that there needs to be a much greater sense of a proper plan for the city. I mean, one thing we've criticised certainly is the fact that we have a consultation for Milton Road and Histon Road going on, and at the same time we have a consultation for the whole of the city. I mean, you thought you'd sort of get a strategy first and then you have Milton Road. But the fact is that it is the direct routes that do go where people want to go. What we've seen over the last 15 years in the city is a lot of work by the county, very good work, to improve the sort of cycle routes that meander through the areas, bridges and so on. But I mean, if we a lot of these routes, they're very difficult to follow. They're not very direct. They're slow. These routes go where you want. So I would really disagree with that. I think you seem to be judging it on the basis of what Milton Road is currently like. And actually, as I think some of the pictures showed, it could be a beautiful road to cycle on. There's absolutely no reason it couldn't be both. And it's direct.
Martin, you show the cyclist just going in one direction on your diagram you just removed from it.
Yeah.
Can you put it back to the cross?
At the end.
No, the one you were
Second
ago. That one, the cross section. Yeah. So you're showing cyclists on one side of the road heading north and on the other side of the road heading south.
That's right.
One of the issues we've got is that school children in particular have to get from, say, Arbury Road down to Ashen Road. Yeah, under your plans, they would have to cross Milton Road twice. What provisions would you put in to help people cross the road, often in the middle of the road, if you like, so perhaps somewhere halfway between King's Hedges Road and Arbury Road? If you lived in that area, you'd have to cross over a busy road to get into the cycle lane, to come down and then cross again at Ashen Road.
The problem of sort of effective that sort of contrary flow kind of bit is an issue with some cycle provision. I mean, what approaches that you could have sections which do allow a bit of two-way, and it is wide enough to permit that. Don't forget we're talking about 2.5 metres. My colleague Jim here, he's sort of been dealing with this a lot. I mean, Jim, do you have particular sort of knowledge on this, I think. Is that right?
It can be complicated at side roads when you have two-way cycle lanes off-road like that, because drivers find there have been two incidents on Trumpington Road where there's a two-way cycle road. So often, for that sort of route, you should be finding another cut-through away from the main road to mean that people don't have to cross the road twice.
There aren't any. Say from Woodhead Drive, say, yeah, down to the shops, no cut-through.
Well,
there's a cycle path direct. All the kids go down that one.
Yeah, well, we know there are difficult choices.
Thank you. One more question. The lady there. Yes.
Okay. What you are proposing, I think, is actually what we already have, and why can't we just improve what we've got, frankly? We've got the trees, we've got the cycle lanes along Milton Road, they just need to be improved. They're in a terrible condition. I cycle to work every day, I don't even have a car. So I go from Hawthorne Way to Science Park every day, there and back, and I think what it needs is just to do with what we've got, and just improve it, and not start cutting down the trees that are there, and then putting some other funny trees that are actually not even nice. So, I mean, you know, they just look terrible. And I would suggest that we introduce rickshaw taxis, you know, that would be another opportunity for somebody to open a business. So that will cut down, you know, I would be delighted to be rickshawed to Science Park, you know. But frankly, I think we should work with what we've got.
Well, you certainly wouldn't get a rickshaw taxi down the current cycle provision, which is rather difficult to put a payment. But I mean, we do accept that some moving of trees would be needed, and of course you can sort of get. I mean, if we look, well, to get the width.
We don't do that.
Well, okay. I think the question is how you get the width.
That, I think, is enough on the cycle campaign. And Martin, thank you very much indeed. I think many of you know Edward Lee from the recently renamed Smarter Cambridge Transport. And he has a lot of experience in this, and we look forward to hearing what he is going to suggest.
Yes, my name is Edward Lee. I lead the Smarter Cambridge Transport Group. We started out as Better City Deal. Is that better?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Okay. So I put up there the objectives set out in the WSP report for the Milton and Histon roads. And I've underlined and highlighted in red some of the things that I think needs some consideration. The very first thing is to provide comprehensive priority for buses. And this has really set the agenda for the entire set of proposals. We've also got, wherever possible, a provision for cyclists along Milton Road. And I think that's too weak. I think actually cycling has a lot more potential to remove traffic off Milton Road. We've also got to generate options capable of maintaining traffic levels. Well, we already accept that the traffic levels are too high at peak already. So maintaining the traffic levels is not enough. We actually have to reduce peak traffic levels. And we have to consider potential for enhancing the environment. I'm sorry, considering potential is very, very weak. And merely to assess the impact on existing residents really is making no commitment whatsoever to take into account your interests. And those objectives led to this, 20 metres of tarmac edge to edge. I'm sorry, I cannot imagine anywhere within a city where that would be an acceptable form of place setting. Indeed. So why don't we start with a plan to eliminate congestion? Let's start with that. Now, to do that, we need to reduce peak traffic flow by 20%. Now, why 20%? Because that's the difference between stationary traffic, gridlock traffic, and free-flowing traffic. Busy, but free-flowing. Now, you'll all have noticed the difference between term time and holiday time, that the traffic feels like it's greatly reduced during the holiday times. Some people estimate it's 40% lower. It's not. It's measured as between 5 and 15%. It's actually a lot more manageable than you might perceive, this problem. If we manage to reduce the peak traffic flow and eliminate congestion, we actually don't need bus lanes. Because as you'll observe, the buses don't use the bus lanes most of the day. And if we remove the bus lanes, then we have the scope to really improve the streetscape. And as the byproduct of this, by reducing the peak traffic flow, we also meet objectives in lowering environmental impact. That's pollution, air pollution, noise pollution, and carbon footprint. And all of those are important, and all those are very much objectives for the City Council. So this is what I would say we should start with as the ideal road profile. And this is set this can be fit within 16.4 metres. Now, 20 metres is what the consultants have set as their target along Milton Road, but as any of you who know Milton Road, that cannot be achieved all the way along. There are a number of points where it's narrower than that, and they're proposing compulsory purchase in people's gardens in order to acquire the 20 metres. But that's to acquire 20 metres of tarmac edge to edge. Now, this can be tweaked, and it can be adapted to various points along the road. So where we need a lay-by bus stop, if there's enough, we need 19.1 metres in order to accommodate that. And if there isn't the space for a lay-by bus stop, well, we can widen the lane sufficiently so that a car behind the bus can at least see past to see whether it's clear to overtake. A problem that we're seeing on Hills Road is that because it's 3 metres, which is actually only fractionally wider than the bus itself, a vehicle behind simply cannot see whether it's clear to overtake. And it might be pointed out, although vehicles in this country can only be 2.6 metres wide, that's not including the wing mirrors. And if you see, let's say, a cement mixer coming down, the chances are that will be very close to 3 metres. I mean, there is one that is 2.95 metres. So they come head to head, and they have to drive very, very carefully. And then at the junction, we need 18.6 metres in order to accommodate a right filter lane. And still keep the segregated cycle lane. So how do we reduce the congestion? How do we reduce the 20%? How do we take that out? Well, we can start with improving traffic flow. Smart traffic management is basically upgrading and integrating all of the traffic signals, so that they all work together, so that actually you get what's called a green wave going through the city, that the lights are all coordinated. And also that they adapt as issues arise, as congestion moves to different places. You know, if there is an event, you know, an accident on the A14, and suddenly there's an inrush of traffic on a particular radial road, the computer that manages the lights will instantly switch into a program that is already set up to deal with that scenario, and it immediately starts dispersing the traffic as efficiently as possible. We can also make modifications to junctions and bus stops. Now, everyone with local knowledge can very quickly rattle off a few points along Milton Road where the congestion is caused by a poor layout on the road, a poorly positioned bus stop, a junction that is not optimally designed. And now these are things that can be, I mean, just taking one very obvious example. If you look at this, you'll be able to see that there's the yellow hatching marks a bus, the marking of a bus stop here. And if you look really, really closely, you might be able to see that the vehicle that stopped on the bus stop is not in fact a bus. Because what's actually needed here is a loading bay. And the bus stop needs to be further back in the car parking lane right in front of the shops. Now, those sorts of modifications, all those sorts of modifications and access term restrictions, but sorry, some of those modifications are really obvious. Some of them can be experimented with, and Councillor Manning will be talking after me about how some of these things can be trialled in such a way that you can experience what the effects are. Because your intuitions and even the road traffic engineers' models can be very wrong about these things. And particularly when you make more than one modification, how they interact is incredibly difficult to predict. So it's really important that we, wherever possible, try it out and experience it. And Michael Page did this very little, created a slide here that shows how the effect of these right turn bans that are being proposed will lead the traffic to follow the rut runs, which are already used, but will become very much more heavily routed, very much more heavily used. And as Claire mentioned earlier, an obvious thing that we could look to do is staggering the start times for schools, shops and businesses. There is a degree of flexibility, and you may have seen programmes about how secondary school pupils should really be starting school later in the day, starting at 10 o'clock. Well, why don't we? Certainly shops, some shops could start later and stay open till a bit later. And businesses could just be a bit more flexible about when their employees work. Now I'm going to talk to you about something which I think could make a really big difference. It doesn't solve the problem, but it provides a really useful tool for controlling congestion. It's what we call inbound flow control. Now looking at Milton Road, from the Science Park Junction through to Mitchell's Corner is 2.5 kilometres. Now if that was gridlocked, we'd need to take out 20% of the traffic in order to get it moving again. Now another way we might achieve that is if we could stretch the road by 20%. And that would open up the gaps between the vehicles enough for them to be able to flow again. Now stretching by 20% means adding 500 metres. Could we find 500 metres for those cars before Science Road Junction? Science Park Junction? Well, yes, we could. In fact, that section of road is actually very wide. There's a large central reservation right down the middle of it. It's 500 metres long, 580 metres long, and it's 26 metres wide. Now it currently has standard 3.65 metre lanes, three inbound, three outbound, and it has a speed limit of 50 miles an hour. Well, if we reduce the lane width to 3.2 metres and reduce the speed limit and reduce the central reservation, we could actually accommodate eight lanes there. That would actually provide us with 1,300 metres of additional road. We only needed 500, but one of the advantages of actually going for more is that we already have a problem with traffic backing up to the A14. And if it backs up onto the slip roads and you start having stationary cars at the bottom of the slip ramp, that's incredibly dangerous. We have to address that. And this would address it without actually touching the A14. The buses would use the leftmost lane coming in, and that lane would be exclusively for access to Cowley Road. So all traffic that's going into the St John's Innovation Park into the Cambridge Business Park would use that lane along with the buses. The private traffic would disperse very quickly, so it wouldn't hold up the buses. And it would go in through the dogleg through Milton, through Cowley Road, and come out ahead of the traffic lights at the Science Park Junction. We would also, so we'd have to re-engineer that island in order to provide a through route for the buses. We'd also relocate this bus stop, which at the moment is on Milton Road, and clearly contributes to congestion, because if a bus stops there and unloads people, then it's holding up the traffic behind it. So we'd move that bus stop onto the end of Cllr just before the point where it re-emerges with Milton Road. And that bus stop is actually within 6-7 minutes walking distance of the furthest point of the science park. So it's perfectly possible for people to walk from there across the pedestrian crossing that we would propose here, and then across Milton Road and into the science park or the Cambridge Business Park. Now that was the easy stuff. That's the stuff that doesn't require us to change our behaviour or our habits. The other thing we have to do is we have to reduce the demand, because there is a cap on, there is a limit on the amount of traffic that the city can cope with. The centre of the city cannot be, we can't dual carriage the inner ring road. We can't create any more capacity within the city centre. So that means we have to reduce the peak demand and we have to hold it there permanently. And that's a big ask. So how do we do achieve that? Well, one thing we can do is we can make it a lot easier for people to take the bus into the city. And that means building park and ride sites throughout the region, not just around the edge of the city, but in places like Camborne, in places like North Stoke, and in places like Waterbeach, Haverhill, places where large numbers of people are travelling, and also groups of village, Hardwick could do with one, Cottenham could do with one. And the idea is that this is a point which has proper services, has a shelter, has toilets, has secure cycle racks, has car parking, has a set down and pick up area, maybe even has a kiosk selling coffee. And if we have these networks around the region, it makes it a hell of a lot more attractive for people to come by bus. We also need to phase out free commuter parking. At the moment, it's really, really clear, particularly now that there's a £1 charge on the park and ride sites, that it is hugely distorting to the incentive. It's a hugely distorting incentive if people can drive into the city and park for free. We actually have to make it so that if you are coming into the city, you either use a park and ride site or you go to a paid parking site. And that. And that will affect you, and that means that you, if you currently park on the road, then that will either mean you have to have a residence parking scheme, or if you don't park on the road, then you'll need parking restrictions on the road for visitors and engineers or whatever are coming to visit, service your boiler. We need to figure this out citywide. There's no use doing it in one little patch that just pushes the problem a little bit further. We also need to restrict the traffic on the inner ring road. The inner ring road is already pretty critical and it's going to become even more critical. We've calculated that between 250 and 300 buses per hour will be arriving in the city centre by 2031. If those buses are not to all be gridlocked in the middle of the city, we really have to remove as much traffic as possible from the inner ring road. And that really means introducing points along the ring road where private vehicles cannot go through. The buses can, the cycles can, but not other motor vehicles. We need to do a lot more to encourage walking and cycling, and that means making it more attractive, educating people about where they can, how they can walk and cycle to places that are along safe routes, and really doing just more to educate people about the alternative and encouraging them for health reasons as much as for anything else to walk and cycle more. We need to make the bus services more attractive. I mean, this ties in with providing the park and ride sites, but those bus services, they need to be express services. They don't need to be winding through the back streets of all the villages on the route, and they need to connect with other services really easily. And if you're coming in from Camborne, you can change to a bus service that takes you to the Science Park, or to Adam Brooks, or to the Marshall business area. And I mean, when you talk to people about why they don't take the bus, it's because the journey that they can do by car takes 20 minutes. When they try to do it by bus, it takes an hour and a half. Yeah. Yes. And finally, we need to run more train services. There's a huge untapped potential in the rail network, particularly east of Cambridge, the new market line, to carry hugely more people into the city. If there was a station that served full-born Tavisham and Cherry Hinton, and we also had a station at Addenbrookes, that would mean all those people in 20,000 houses in the Fulbourne area would be able to get to Addenbrookes Hospital without getting in a car. That would make a huge difference to the volume of traffic that's trying to get through the city. And really what I would conclude with on that is that although some of those measures are going to mean that you have to change your habits and will change the way that you live, we will all have to walk more, we will all have to cycle more, we'll all have to take the bus, and we'll all have to drive only when it's actually necessary, not just when it's slightly more convenient. And that's good for us, that's good for our health, it's good for the city, and it's good for the planet. So thank you.
Indeed,
we are running quite long. Three questions, please. Right at the back, please, Richard. Thank you. There was a very interesting article in The Guardian this morning on bus regulation and deregulation, and it talked about the level of satisfaction in certain cities in Britain. And I think it was Nottingham, it was 92%, and in East Lothian or West Lothian, I can't remember which, it was 96%. And my question is what is the level of satisfaction of the bus service in Cambridge? And there seemed to be a very strong correlation between level of satisfaction and regulation. And I wonder if this topic should actually be included. I know that the council this week said we don't want to set up a bus company, but I know very little about this. In fact, although this morning I was on a bus in London and it was wonderful on one of these brand new buses. Very stylish, and the article this morning said that anyone using a bus over 30 has failed in life. Well, that's dreadful, isn't it? And I fear that there's this regulation, deregulation word should actually be a very strong part of the debate.
There was regulation in the Queen's speech specifically on empowering local councils, local authorities, to have more control over how to allow them to franchise bus services. Unfortunately, it's conditional on having an elected mayor, and we're some steps away from actually from having that. But I think from memory, the quality of life survey that Cambridge Ahead did about satisfaction with buses, I think it was about 56%. So it was not high. And it really is very clear that a lot needs to be done to improve the quality of reliability services. And it is not just about the reliability in terms of the time lost due to congestion on radial roads. It's about the whole service. It's the door-to-door journey experience that really matters that we need to look at.
Other questions? Yes, please. And then...
I found that very enlightening, thank you very much. As we've got some representatives of the City Deal here, some members from the board, I believe, I just wondered what their response to be. What do they find wrong with that presentation?
Just a quick point about the first part. I agree with the second part about holding back traffic and allowing it to flow freely. I spend a lot of time, particularly today, trying to cross Milton Road on my bike to go off onto the side road. So if I actually benefit when it's gridlocked or when the traffic lights are holding traffic. I'm sorry to say, because I spent absolutely ages this morning watching traffic continually flow slowly. So the more it gets like that, the more the traffic becomes a barrier in the middle of a residential area, from my point of view.
You're absolutely right, actually. But imagine what it's going to be like trying to cross a four lanes of traffic.
Oh, yeah, no, of course. Yeah.
So, I mean, if that's the alternative, I don't see that as being attractive. I mean, it simply won't be possible to cross the road between traffic lights most of the day when it's 20 metres, when you've got to cross two cycle lanes, two bus lanes, and two traffic lights. But you know, there could come a point where we could actually put pedestrian crossings between the junctions, actually to encourage people to cross. And certainly, where we've got shops That's an obvious place to have, a zebra crossing, actually. I mean, I know there's a pelican crossing just up the road from there. But once you've sort of brought traffic under control and you've reduced the volume of traffic, you have a lot more flexibility about how you interrupt it, because there is that much more capacity. At the moment, the priority is to keep the traffic moving, because there's no overflow space. There's no sort of balloon that the traffic can sort of, that you can store the traffic in. What we're proposing does provide you that. And once it's connected into the traffic management system, you can actually you can regulate the flow of traffic much more flexibly.
Thank you very much. Edward, thank you.
Stand up and stretch and the way things do. It's been quite a long session. I had to step out in front of you.
Could those who are leaving please leave? Thank you. Thank you, all the rest of you, for staying. It's really good to have the opportunity to hear Councillor Ian Manning talk about trialling, which means testing it before you get stuck on it, because that's a thing on which he has strong feelings, and we ought to hear about it.
Thank you very much. Did everyone hear me?
Yes.
Brilliant. I'm just a county council for East Cheshire. I'm not part of the city deal hierarchy or anything like that. And this is just a little bit about a policy that I got through unanimously. This is not a party political thing or anything like that. It's been agreed by all political groups of the county council, broadly speaking. So I just want to tell you about why it's a good thing in terms of the city deal schemes and why, and just an example of where it's been used successfully to get the best deals for residents, which is, after all, I think, why you're all here. A bit about background to this. The two people on that slide are the key people who got this in New York. Chap on the left is Michael Bloomberg, who used to be the mayor of New York, and the woman on the right is the woman who implemented all this, Janine Sidney Khan. And if you've got time after this and you like the idea of it, please go to the TED website, because she does an amazing talk on this, because she actually did this. It's far more inspiring than I could be. But the basic gist of it is that Bloomberg, being a bit of a sort of hard-nosed businessman, what he wanted to do, rather than having huge amounts of bureaucracy and it taking years and years to do anything, his concept was do it quickly, do it cheaply, and trial it live in the street. So you don't get into these conversations about what might happen if you block this road off here, where's all the traffic going to go. You try it for a period of time. It's not slapdash, it's not hazard. Bloomberg's a huge data freak. He measured, made huge loads of measurements of where all the traffic went, how it affected the flows. And it's a lot about the fact that someone mentioned earlier that the ideas and any of the solutions are incredibly complicated. Edward was talking about how they all interrelate in ways that it is impossible to predict. And this is what Bloomberg cottoned onto, where you try it all, you can find out what really happens, and you can find out what happens when humans, who don't always behave like computer models, start to use these things. So the net result, and I'm going to go into one of the big examples from New York, and one example from where we've done it in Cambridgeshire. So the net result in New York was Times Square in New York, if anyone's been there, back in 2009. It was pretty much like a really, really large, even worse version of Newmarket Road, if you can imagine that. Apologies, I'm trying to look at a picture that's smaller. The picture on the left is pre-mid-2009. The picture on the right is after Bloomberg trialed the idea of blocking it off and making it pedestrian only. There's this amazing story about how this is this incredibly controversial thing. All the local businesses were against it. This is going to be, and I'll be interested to hear from the business owners of which he thinks of this actually, but all the local businesses say it's going to destroy our trade, cars can't get in, we're all going to, our livelihoods are out. But the net result was that their takings went up. So not only do you have all the wonderful stuff about less air pollution, it became a peak place that people could go to, actually there was a massive economic benefit to it. And of all the stats from 7-odd years of doing this now, the one I'm most a fan of is that if you measure since 2011 to 2015, which is the last big period they did measure this, the number of fatalities on the road dropped to the lowest level since records began in 1910. So people not dying, I would say, is quite a good thing. So I think by that, it's actually, there was one slight aside for the whole thing, is actually on the first night, they were this was the very first thing they did on this trialing methodology, and they were supposed to order this sort of malleable kit to try and do this sort of streetscape layout. It didn't arrive in time, so Bloomberg had to run out with his checkbook to a hardware store, bought a load of plastic seats and deck chairs, put them everywhere as a last-ditch thing to fill the square up. And the next day, everyone was going, why on earth did you buy a blue deck chair? That's crazy! No one was talking about this, the fact that he just changed a major bit of New York's transport infrastructure. So if you take away one thing from this example, there's lots of other examples from this program, because running for a long time. If you can block off a major part of one of the world's largest and busiest cities and trial it successfully, and residents eventually and businesses end up accepting it, I think we can do a couple of roads in Cambridge as a trial.
Yay.
Very briefly, so two more things. One is about why I think as residents this is important to you. So unless you're in the camp that is implacably completely opposed to any changes or is just wants everything to change, I think you're probably, I would hope, in a sense, you're not sure that some of these things will work. You might want to, if you're really for it, you get to prove that it works, like you don't. And if you're against it, and I'll go on record and say I don't think you can trial removing trees, but if you're against it, you can prove that it doesn't work, and that you don't get into these arguments. That's why I think this is particularly relevant in such a complex scheme like city deal proposals. Sorry, this is something I mentioned earlier, I'll just go over this, but the point here
was... No, please go. Please go on something which isn't party political. We're not doing any of that.
My point is it's not part of political. We have agreement across the county council, we've got five political groups, so if anything's a good idea, it can get through unanimously. That was all my point.
All right.
So, and this ended with a motion passed in March 2014. I'm just going to finish with one decent example of a trialing scheme we've actually done in Cambridgeshire, and just to show you the sort of thing you can do with small-scale trials. Next one's quite big. Just goes to go this. This was just saying that there are quite significant legal differences between New York Mayor's powers and the County Council's powers. Bob from the County Council smiled at that. The next slide will wait in a minute. So I'll just try, while it's loading, I'll try and describe it, which is going to be a bit difficult. But, essentially, there was it was done in Whittlesea, and there was a need to from the local residents to do a pinch point in a road nearby a pub, and the question was essentially whereabouts the pinch point was put. They did the trial very simple. They just rather than doing just guessing and modelling it, because obviously people, they just put cones out on the road where the pinch point would be, and they moved the cones around, and they observed what happened with the traffic flow. And the thing about that was not just that they found what they thought was an optimal location, which they wouldn't necessarily have done. It was that they noticed when they were doing this that there was parking further down the street. It didn't always happen, but when it did happen, and the optimal location was in, the cones were in the optimal location, it was actually more dangerous because it became unsighted. Unfortunately, this next slide's not loading for some reason, and it would have shown you that. But the point was that in the normal run of things, you would have consulted, found this optimal location quite possibly, put this restriction in, would have been fine for a little while, and then you would have noticed that it actually became more dangerous than it was before, and you would spend another year consulting about what to do about bringing in parking restrictions. By doing the trialing methodology, you were able to find this out, and you brought it all in at once. So, not only was it better for the residents, it actually saved money. So, I think, just to sum up, the whole point and concept of this, I think it allows you to do radical things, try radical things out. You might be otherwise wary of doing,
to do them
very, very cautiously, because you do the cautiousness is the fact that these trials strictly always have to be temporary. Even if they are a success, they are still taken away, and you then consult upon what you want to actually do permanently. And that's why I think with a lot of the changes around the city deal, blocking off individual roads, making roads one way, all this sort of stuff, it's a really strong thing to get behind as residents, because it stops us getting into these debates about what might or might not happen and might still get to the best results. So thank you very much.
apologies for interrupting.
Sorry, just a quick question. When you're doing the trials, and you say the local residents can comment and so on, how is that tabulated? How is it analysed?
At the end of the experiment. Well, when they did it in New York, they had things like QR codes and websites.
Yes, in our context.
The Whittlesea trial is not a good example for that, because it was something that the residents wanted to do anyway. They knew they wanted to make a change there. It was just how they made the change. We did put a paper together about a year ago on which had a load of criteria for how I didn't go into that. Told I wanted to get through this quickly, but there is a paper that I could circulate which had some ideas for how you would test these things, and they were things like consulting the local residents. And I mean, this is not a panacea in the sense it doesn't get you around the classic problem, which is, you know, if you've got a bunch of residents on the road who will want something or don't want something, but the people outside of that, you know, are the opposite opinion, you've still got that fundamental issue. What this gets round is problems where you get a two groups at loggerheads over what ifs, because you can at least try these things out and you know the results. So, you know, there's no exact, you know, there is a set of criteria which I haven't brought because it's very, very long. But ultimately, you've got to ask questions about what you want to achieve and what you think a success criteria would be up front, which, you know, is a lot. There's no right or wrong answer to.
Yes, I understand that, but I presumed you were mentioning this in relation to the junctions and the restrictions and so on. And there, of course, we've got that problem, which people have already identified, of locals, local traffic, and commuter traffic. And my question is how that is assessed after the experiment.
That's not really, I mean, it's not to do with the fact we're trialing it, because you still don't fundamentally get an answer to that question.
My question is what does trialing relate? How does the trialing you're talking about?
Well, so, for example, say you look at one of the proposals.
I'm asking you how you're relating the trialing to some of the problems that you've identified.
So Milton Road, for example, you would trial Milton Road by putting planters at the end of the Milton Road.
Yeah, but
Milton
how
Road.
Do you assess it? Who gathers data?
Well, that
is good or bad.
That's an open question. Well, I'm not going to decide that right now. I've not got, frankly, the authority to decide that.
So we can't do anything like this because there's no method or there's no system where somebody would.
I think if I decided right now how we were going to do it before we even decided what we were going to try.
Okay.
I think you've probably gone marginally beyond Ian's remit.
Just a factual point, if I could.
Sorry, Board Member Skibbereth, County Council, just. Explain a bit about experimental.
Use the microphone!
Sorry. Bob Menger, Skibbereth County Council, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Just to explain about experimental traffic regulation orders, possibly help answer the question. You can introduce a change, a pedestrianised area, a regulatory change, ban a turn, close a road, whatever, under an experimental process. You do it for 18 months. You have to do a consultation during that period. After 6 months, a consultation, you can express their views. You would then do all the traffic counts, all the traffic surveys, and actually exactly how much traffic was using the alternative route, what was the noise impact, etc. You would assess all that. It then has to go back to the councillors. So county councillors give that to the committee, city board would go to the board, and they then have to assess both the comments, the objections made, and the figures, and that's where the process works. Just to explain that, right? We're getting a bit of a...
Any other questions specifically on the trialing process? Thank you very much, Bob. Okay, Ian, thank you. So leave that up. I like the title at the top. We'll keep that. Now, I said at this point we'd have a panel discussion. I'm not going to do that. We've been here long enough. You've been very patient, and you've been a very good audience. Interesting. So thank you very much indeed. Thank you to those who came to listen, those who came in their council capacities to listen, as well as those who came and spoke. You've given us an interesting evening, and I think it should advance the argument quite well. But there has to be something done, and we just want to make sure that what is done doesn't destroy Milton Road. Thank you. It sounds very reassuring that the council leader assured us that this is an open consultation. So we're not necessarily going to be tinkering what I think everyone thinks is a flawed process. That's really good. So that's the end of it. What do we do next? Well, if you haven't already looked at the plans in detail, there's one more exhibition. It's here at the Chesterton Community College on Monday evening. The important meeting, which we all ought to go to, is again here, the North Area Committee meeting on the 4th of February at 6 o'clock, specifically ask questions about all this consultation. And we'll have Councillor Herbert and whoever he's chosen to bring with him to take our questions. So think about it. Think what questions you want to ask. Prepare them so that they're coherent and clear, and then come and ask them. Please file your replies to the questionnaire. That's this thing. It's got to be done by the 15th, but the later you do it, then the more informed you will be. Watch out for the questions. Some of them don't relate very well to the issue. So make maximum use of that big white box to write in freehand what you really want. And you can do it online. You'd rather not take this paper. I think that's enough. Thank you, Anthony, for doing the video of it. Thank you, Chester Community College, if there's anyone here, for letting us have the room. Thank you, Minuteman Press, for printing all these, which is what brought you here.
Charles will say thank you to Richard.
I'm sorry. Richard, I see you hiding in the corner. When you go out, if you're prepared to help in any way, would you please, it's things like carrying the Save Our Trees petition round for an hour somewhere. If you do that, would you please let Barbara Taylor outside have your name, right? And if you could spare a quid or so for the running costs of this organisation, because there are minor costs, then it will be helpful. So thank you all very much for coming. I'm being waved at because I'm supposed to advertise FECRA, the Federation of Cambridge Residents Association, any of the newly forming Residents Association. See Tanya.
Yes, I think
that's it.
A new Residents Association is formed in the 90s.